High society.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to a new episode of Chatting with Lady Soon. Hello, Mum, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you, honey, and you?
I'm very well, thank you.
Like the shirt?
It's a jumper. It's Gemma's mum that gave it to me.
Really? It's very nice.
My brother didn't want it, and I was like, well, I'll take it. I like it.
I like it too. Very chic. Very chic. And Mickey, I think, likes it too. Mickey has decided she wants to join us today. Yes, Mix. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. So, do we have any interesting questions?
Yes. So, for our first question today is from Mark Frank. Why was Castle Goring named after the Nazi general? Why not change the name?
Mickey, do you approve of that question? Oh, well, Castle Goring was built in the 1800s. It was built by Sir Bysshe Shelley, the poet's grandfather, the great romantic poet, one of the three great British romantic poets of the 19th century. Reich Marshal Hermann Goring, it's spelled Goring but with an umlaut, so it is pronounced Goring, was born in the, I don't remember when he was born, but he would have been born in the latter part of the 19th century. And he was a World War I hero who became the head of the Luftwaffe and was condemned to death at Nuremberg and cheated the hangman's noose by taking a dose of cyanide the night before his execution. Patently, he was born long after this castle was built and named. The name of this local town, after which the castle and the estate upon which the castle sits, is Goring. It's not Goring, it's Goring. So there would be no need to change the name. And even if it had been the identical name to Goring, had Goring not been Goring but Goring, I would fail to see why one should change the name because somebody who came afterwards did things that were things that we disapprove of. I mean, you know, this dodging of history and this rewriting of history and this sort of distancing ourselves from history. I think we should learn from history. I see no merit in pretending that something that happened and that was distasteful or destructive or whatever word you want to use for it, it didn't exist and you just expunge it. You know, no, I think that even had it been, his name been Goring, he came after this and this is entitled to exist and why would we change the name? So no, I wouldn't change it at all, even if I had the choice, and I don't. Even if I wanted to change the name, which I under no circumstances would want to, there is no way I would be allowed to change the name. Because this is a Grade One listed stately home. It's regarded as one of the most important buildings in the country architecturally. We are not allowed to cut down a tree or alter a doorway, much less change the name of it. I mean, it's so even if we wanted to, we couldn't. But thank you very much for your question, Mr. Frank. It was a very interesting question, but it wasn't named after Goring, so there's no need to change the name. But next question, honey.
No worries. So for our next question today is from Tisha Zachary. I still would like to know, while Meghan lived in Canada for 7 years, she wasn't a leader and or spokesperson fit their organization actors against racism. Never a peep.
Very interesting question. So there is something called Actors Against Racism in Canada, which is very interesting. I didn't know that. And Meghan wasn't a leader or a spokesperson for it. No. Quite right. Never a peep. No. Because, of course, Meghan was, in those days, a jobbing actress who was making her way in the world. And she only once she became friendly with Serena Williams did she discover that there was mileage to be had in being a woman of color. But limited mileage, we have to understand. Even when she was in England, it was very limited mileage, you know. I'm in South Africa, so I'm going to tell you that I'm a woman of color just like all of you. For 2 seconds, but, you know, with the straightened hair and the nose bob, etc., etc., which is fair dues if she wants to do it. But, you know, she has jumped on the bandwagon. I think Tisha Zachary has alighted upon the fact that Meghan was noticeably inactive at a time that had she really been had heartfelt sentiments on the matter, she would have been active. But you see, there was no money to be made from it. There was no mileage to be gained from it that she could perceive. It's only when she could perceives that there was mileage to be made. And I am not convinced that Meghan alone is the proponent of all of these grabs for, I'm a woman of color, I'm disturbed, I know everything about mental illness, not that I've ever had it. You know, all the poses that she affects and all of the postures that she deploys. I think her PR people are behind a lot of it. And Sunshine Sachs is a very capable PR organization, and they are very adept at, playing the system. They're operators, and Meghan's an operator, and they're earning their money, and, you know, they're the ones who've noticed the gap in the market and have obviously said to her, you know, Meghan, you know, you got to reconnect with that little bit of color that you've got in you, and, you know, sort of, I don't know if you notice, every now and then she sort of, the face is infinitely darker than the hands. I mean, for instance, in the video with Archie, where she's reading, her hands are 6 degrees paler than her face. But I suppose it's okay for Meghan to use a brown face, although, of course, it's now deplored for white people to use black face. But I suppose it's okay for a woman of slight colour to brown up if it's going to make her some money. And I think it's as cynical as that. I really do. So, yes, Miss Zachary or Mrs. Zachary, you've spotted something, yeah. Oh, dear Meg is at it yet again, opportunistic to the nth degree. You know, history teaches us that there are loads of people who jump on bandwagons. Throughout history, there have been phases where something was fashionable and people jumped on the bandwagon. And down the line, it did not behoove them to do so. Or, as in the case of Meghan, They didn't jump on the bandwagon when they should have and could have, and it would have rarely showed that they were somebody of integrity and sincerity. They've done it only when they've been told, there's a gap in that market, you know, Meg. You're a woman of colour. Yeah, you've got to jump in there. Opportunism of the highest order. Shall we go on to the next question, honey? Sure.
So for our next question today, my question for Lady C, what is the wildest story you've heard in high circles? No names, just juicy details, please. Thank you.
God, can I see that? The wildest story. Well, there are one or two pretty wild stories. I don't remember if I put it in one of my books, and I will mention the name. But the Princess of Wales was seen in flagrante delicto in the grounds of a certain house, having it off with her boyfriend. I have a feeling I wrote about it in one of my Diana books. I don't remember whether it was cut out or not. And I could be wrong, but I think she was having it off with James Hewitt in the bushes. She certainly, so that's, I suppose that qualifies as fairly wild.
It's going there.
Even wilder, well, beyond wild actually, was a very famous, very beautiful society hostess, shall we say. Very beautiful she was. She had a very handsome nephew, her eldest sister's child, who was gorgeous looking. And they hadn't really grown up together, and there was a big age gap between the eldest sister and this sister. And so she was really more or less a little bit older than the nephew, but not that much older. And they had a teensy-weensy affairette that I knew about. It never was made public. And it wasn't anything serious. And they were, you know, they were never going to have a fully fledged relationship in terms of that aspect of it. But they were very fond of each other, and they remained fond of each other for the whole of her life. And so I suppose, I don't know how wild that is, if that qualifies as well, but to me that certainly qualifies as extraordinary. What do you think?
Oh, I didn't think that was too wild.
You didn't?
No.
And what about Diana having it off in the bushes?
Normal thing, I would say.
Yeah, that's not wild either. No. Oh, God. Well, I'm afraid I'm very dull and boring, and I can't think of anything wilder than those two. I really can't. Oh, a very famous movie star who was very much a swordsman. Told me one day, he said, you know, I'm a very naughty boy, he said. I was crossing St. James's Park, and this girl gave me the eye, and he said, we sort of chatted, and we said, how about it? And they did it in St. James's Park. Can you believe it?
Yeah, I can.
And then they parted their ways, and he went his way, she went hers, and he told me about it. I thought, wow, suppose you've been caught. But I think that was half the fun where they were concerned. Is that wild?
Yes.
A little bit wilder.
A bit, because it's in St. James's Park.
Yeah, well, I'm afraid you know, I'm actually very dull and boring. I'm a good Catholic girl who believes in missionaries. So I'm afraid that I don't go beyond that. So if there's anything else that I can think of, I will keep it to myself. I can't think of anything else either. So
for our next question today, it's from JP Prague. He's asked quite a few questions, so I'm just going to say one by one and she will reply. So, for the first one out of the many, who is someone alive that you admire?
Who is someone alive that I admire? Oh, many people. Oh, why don't I just stick with the Queen? I admire the Queen greatly. I think she's a wonderful woman. I think she's a wonderful person, not only as a monarch, but that she's a nice human being. I think she's exemplary in her conduct publicly. And I think she's been a very, very loving and indulgent, too indulgent mother and grandmother. She's a good family woman and she's a good friend. She is a good friend and she's a loyal friend. So let's just stick to the Queen.
So the next one is, do you believe in a higher power?
I most certainly do. I find it extraordinary that anybody could believe that we, mankind, would be the ultimate. I mean, it's ludicrous. Get into a 20-foot boat in the middle of a hurricane and you'll see how insignificant we truly are. I certainly believe in a higher power. I think that there are mysteries which throughout time man has never been able to actually conquer. I think we are no nearer finding out what the mysteries of the universe are. I think no matter how scientific an approach you take, there are explanations beyond which there is no explanation. And I don't care what you call it, whether you call it God or a higher power or force of nature, whatever. There are obviously much greater powers than us. And I would be inclined to think that we as human beings are so insignificant and so limited that we will never be able to unravel mysteries like this. Mm. It's like I can't work a phone properly. If I were pretentious, I'd be deciding that I know how computers work. And I think, and you know, trying to pontificate and explain, I think I'm not denigrating man's attempt to explain and to try to unravel the mysteries, because I think, yes, it's constructive to do that. But I think it behooves us to remember our place in the scheme of things and how really very insignificant we are and how very limited and how very little we truly know. I mean, we know a very great deal compared with what we used to know, but still very insignificant. Next question.
All right.
Well, what do you think?
I think there's stuff that we could do in the past, like the Egyptians could do, and we don't even know how they did it. So that tells you already a lot right there, how they were probably smarter than us.
Well, in some ways, yeah.
In some ways, in a lot of ways. But also, they had water going up to the temples, pyramids, sorry. Where now there's no water, but the Nile used to flow water all the way up to the pyramids, and they used to use the current of the water through the pyramids into the fields to grow their stuff. There's so many things that back then that people used to do, like transport these massive statues by hand, but we need a crane. There's a lot of stuff that we haven't learned from our past.
Well,
and we're trying to figure out our future up there, but we can't in space. That's why I'm pointing up there. But we don't know anything about our water. and we live on this planet. But hey, that's our generation for you.
Right. Well, yes, of course, the reality is that the early Christians deliberately destroyed 95% of the knowledge of the classical world, because they thought knowledge was rubbish, that faith was everything. Well, of course, knowledge is not rubbish. And if God had, and I do believe that there is a higher power, and I choose to call it God, and I do believe that, you know, we should embrace knowledge as well as faith. The two things are not mutually exclusive. Unfortunately, many established religions, or many religions as they are seeking to gain power and a hold over more and more people, are try to destroy knowledge, because knowledge stands in the way of them gaining an ascendancy over a population. It's about power. It's not about God.
Or going to the future is like the gentleman. A lot of people would know this probably, like the gentleman that found the self-charging battery. So the battery never died. That was on the news for a week, and then we never heard of him again. What do you think happened to him? He's either dead
or that he's
been
off.
Hired, yeah, or yeah. Been paid off.
Well, I mean, the electric bulb is the absolute ideal example of that. The very first electric bulbs never, ever ran out. So the very first item in the modern world that had built-in obsolescence was the electric bulb, because they very quickly figured out, if we manufacture these electric bulbs and they last in perpetuity, you know, we're not going to make enough money. So they built in obsolescence.
So it's about making more money. It's like electric cars. You can see that they don't want to get rid of petrols, but they're all these companies now are introducing hybrids, so it's half electric, half petrol. And the day that they need to be on a full electric, they're there already, because they're already also making full electrics, of course. But like on one of these car shows, this gentleman said, even if we all went electric, we don't have the power sources to be able to function all of London, the electricity that people use, plus recharging all the cars, plus everything else.
That's right. Next question, hon.
All right. So for our next question, will you go to your grave with grudges, and does it matter?
No, I will not go to my grave with grudges. Yes, it does matter. But there is a difference between accepting reality and deluding oneself as to the realities of life. There are people in each of our lives, I would imagine, who have wounded one. And I am always happy to forgive, but I don't forget. If you forget, you forget the lesson that you need to learn. I think our spiritual journey requires us to embrace the realities of life, not to deny them, and not to comfort ourselves by lying to ourselves and pretending that people are nicer than they are, or indeed that they are worse than they are. And, you know, I have forgiven people in the past who did terrible things to me, some of whom I let back into my life, and they then did other terrible things. I'm referring to your grandmother. There are also other people like my father who really, one would hardly say that he was always sweetness and light and kindness, but I forgave him We moved on from that and we ended up having a perfectly good relationship because Daddy's mistakes were born of human fallibility, but not necessarily a bad heart. Mummies were born of malice, and malicious people, if you give them a chance to be malicious again, they will be malicious again because it's in their nature. So it's not a matter of harboring grudges because, as you know, for instance, you know, when Mummy was dying, I took myself halfway across the world once every 6 weeks to spend my regulatory week with her and help her with whatever she needed help with, etc., etc. So I did not exclude her, but the fact of the matter is, you know, Mummy was one of those people who will always bite the hand that feeds it and kept on doing it, even as she was dying. That's just what some people do. Is that harboring a grudge? No. It's just acknowledging the reality of the person. I think you can actually love people who are not perfect. And there are some people who, I will now refer to my ex-husband, whom I used to love. And I have never, that part of what I felt, you know, you don't expunge it, it doesn't disappear, it doesn't die. But other things replace it and you move on from it. And I would never let him back into my life because I know him to be what he is. I know him to be the sociopath that Erica Freeman confirmed to me that he was. And you cannot cure sociopathy. So there's no point in deluding yourself and saying, well, I'll give somebody another chance. Not that he necessarily would want it. And even if he did, he'd never get it. Absolutely never. Mummy was my mother, so I kept on giving her chances, but I wouldn't give him another chance. But that doesn't mean that I harbor a grudge. I simply acknowledge what happened. And, you know, I don't think in life it suits you to delude yourself, but equally doesn't suit you to be bitter about what happened. You can accept something, move on from it, acknowledge it for what it was, and still be happy and whole and still be loving. I think what one doesn't want to do is become embittered, you know? What do you think?
I think it. What you were just saying is like some people don't forget and hold on to something when they should just let go, and then they're like, but I don't know how to. It's like, well, it's very easy, just let go.
yeah, just let go. But that doesn't mean you need to forget. I don't forget anything. I don't forget a kindness, and I don't forget anything else either. You know, why should you? I mean, it's all a part of the rich tapestry of life. You don't have to forget. You can actually remember, but not hold on to the malice, you know. And on that note, my dear, shall we move on to something more pleasant? If he has any other questions, does he?
Yes, there's a few more.
Well, shall we do one more?
Well, it's one and a half.
Okay, so let's do that.
One of them's quite longish.
Okay.
So, why did you decide to keep the unmatching facade of the castle?
Okay. First of all, what helps to make Castle Goring interesting is that it has dual facades that completely are different. You know, on the north facade is Gothic and the south facade is Greco-Roman. And so this is what makes this building unique. It's also the very first building in the country that ever had a purpose-built dual facade that was so radically different. even if I wanted to change it, I would not be allowed to change it because this is a Grade 1 listed building and there is no way English Heritage would allow me to change
it. Imagine the work as well, ripping down half of that.
It would cost millions.
Half of the house.
It would cost millions. So it's not feasible. But anyway, it's an interesting question to ask. I would imagine that this must be somebody who is American.
It's the gentleman called JP.
Yes. But I would imagine that Mr. Prigg must be American because if he were English, I mean, he might be aware of the fact that we have historic England monitoring everything that we do in Grade 1 listed houses.
Yes, I'm looking at grand design at the moment. Mm. It's roughly around 8 o'clock in the evening.
Mm.
And it's really cool. It's this Indian couple, a little bit underneath Scotland, so like in the Midlands somewhere. And they bought land to build their house on.
Mm.
The house is modern, the interior is beautiful, the outside, I don't think, I would have done it a little bit more older, but it's their choice, their house, they built it there. But, but they've got this ruin in the background that they could not touch.
Mm.
So the historical grade A and all that made sure that they build a house that would suit the building that's falling down behind them.
Yes, yes.
And they agreed to it, but it doesn't suit the building behind it.
Yes.
So that's why it's good to have these people that, well, they didn't do their job properly, these people, but usually they do, to keep the old houses preserved.
Yes, you want to preserve your heritage. You want, you know, this business of ripping down things and rewriting history. I mean, I know because I'm a creature of the 60s and 70s and 50s when the craze for tearing down old buildings and building new was at its height.
Mm-hmm.
And not only in America, but in Jamaica. And, you know, Jamaica lost many of its really magnificent old buildings when, in fact, and they put up concrete monstrosities, which, you know, looking back on it now, it's such a pity. I mean, in New York, they tried to tear down the Metropolitan Opera House, and Jackie Kennedy said no, and she spearheaded the campaign for them to keep it. Thank God. And we now have an awareness of the fact that all these old buildings and all this heritage should be retained, and we can build around it wherever possible. So next question, honey.
Nice. Will you ever do Celeb Big Brother? And what are your terms?
Well, I don't know that Celebrity Big Brother still exists. Does it?
I think it does. They do the celebrity one and then they do the public one. So they choose random public people.
Oh, okay.
And I think it's still going. Well, I can't really know with COVID because everything's changed. But I think last year it was still on.
Okay. Well,
I'm not sure.
If it's still on, I am always open to any invitation as long as they pay me enough. Because I make no bones about it. I am doing all of the stuff that I do for Goring. And if I didn't have to do it for Goring, I wouldn't do it at all, but as long as I have to do it for Goring, I do it happily. But they would have to pay me enough to make it worth my while. And if they did, and the terms were acceptable, I certainly would not say no.
It's not that hard sitting in a house just chatting.
And it depends who you're with.
Yes, true, because, again, you are a month in there, isn't it?
Is it that long?
I can't remember. I've never looked at Big Brother, to be honest, never looked at it.
Mm.
Never watched one episode.
Mm.
Don't even know what it's about. I only know one person that went on it.
Well, I was... that's Ben.
Only
yes.
Ben, that's the only person. We never even talked about it.
Yeah. Well, I was asked when I came out of the jungle, would I go on Celebrity Big Brother if they asked me? And I said, not for a penny under 5 million. Well, you may as well set the bar high. Yeah. you know, they can then negotiate me down a little bit. But I certainly wouldn't be doing it for the fame and all of that nonsense, which, you know, all those celebs do these things for. I mean, I make no bones about it. Everybody knows. I only do it because of Goring. And I'm happy to do it for Goring. And I meet people that I wouldn't otherwise meet. And I have some very nice times with some very nice people. And then I also have some rather unpleasant and distasteful experiences with people who you'd much rather never have come across. But, you know, that's like, it all adds to the rich tapestry of life, and it all makes life interesting. And it's certainly, all of this stuff has given me a dimension that I would never have ordinarily had in my life. And, you know, one needs to embrace all of it. You know, it's not what I would have hoped for. It's certainly not what I planned for, but it is what it is. And I'm enjoying it to the extent that I can. Mm. And I think that's the secret of life, to make the best of what you have, and don't decry the fact that you don't have what you really would have preferred and didn't get. Mm. I mean, we all, you know, I'm sure we all have hopes that we have not had realized. And it doesn't suit you to focus on that. Just focus on what you have and embrace it and make the best of it.
Just make sure that you take everything as an experience. Mm. And if you take everything as experience, well, then you'll enjoy yourself.
Yes, but some of us don't have the capacity. Some people don't want to enjoy themselves. And some people don't want to embrace what life is offering you because it doesn't fit their scheme of things. Well, most of my life has certainly not fitted my scheme of things. So, you know, but I then had to decide, well, am I going to go along with the life that obviously I am meant to be living, which doesn't really bear that much accord with the life that I expected to lead? Or am I going to make myself miserable about it? And no, I'm not prepared to do that at all. And, you know, people need to embrace life, you know. I think the one lesson life has taught me is that having too many preconceptions about what you require, well, God, destiny, life, other people, however you want to put it, they dictate that often you don't get what you wanted. And I've noticed that people who force solutions to get what they want at any cost usually end up people with very poisoned souls. And I'd much rather have a pure soul or a good soul or a life enhancing and life loving soul than get everything that I want and, you know, be a terrible person. And on that note, honey, I think we've had enough, have we?
There's just the last one.
Another question. Goodness gracious me.
So for the last one of the many, what shows and programs and projects would you like to do within the next 3 years?
Well, that's too all-encompassing for me to answer because
I hate when people ask that question. What are you going to be doing in 5 years? How would I know what I would be doing in 5 years? I could be dead with all you know what's going on right now. So I just dislike that question. It's an interview question. That's why I was doing a lot of interviews earlier this year. And it was just the same one over and over again. And well, you know it off by heart at the end, but it's a terrible question.
Mm. Well, I don't plan that far ahead.
You can't.
Well, I think it's fruitless. And also, I really don't have any ambitions in life aside from surviving as positively and as happily and as constructively and as well as I can. and loving my kids and my dog and cat and my friends and doing the best I can with my life. Beyond that, everything else is minutia. And on that note, I think, thank you very much for your questions. Mr. Prigg, thank you for all your many questions. They were certainly very interesting.
Well, thank you, everybody, and we hope you enjoyed this episode. And if you did, please hit the like button, subscribe, and share with your friends. Thank you very much, and goodbye.